Good morning. Welcome to Lutheran Church of God's Love. I'm Pastor Brandi Hebert. I have the privilege to serve this congregation alongside Pastor Dan Whitener. Pastor Whitener is on a much-deserved vacation this past week. We wish him and his family safe travels as they return later this week on Wednesday. Today we celebrate the fourth Sunday after Pentecost, and we have the opportunity to explore the prophet Jeremiah and our call to prophetic discipleship. So I warmly welcome you all to worship today, those who are visiting with us and those who are worshiping with us online. Let us take a moment to prepare our hearts for worship. Please stand as you are able for confession and forgiveness. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of our neighbors. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned, we have hurt our community, we have squandered your blessings, we have hoarded your bounty. In the name of Jesus, forgive us and grant us your mercy. Righteous God, we confess that we have sinned, we have failed to be honest, we have lacked the courage to speak, we have spoken falsely. In the name of Jesus, forgive us and grant us your mercy. God is a cup of cold water when we thirst. God offers boundless grace when we fail. Claim the gift of God's mercy. You are freed and forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Teach us, good Lord God, to serve you as you deserve, to give and not to count the cost, to fight and not to heed the wounds, to toil and not to seek for rest, to labor and not to ask for reward, except that of knowing that we do your will, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated.
The first reading is from Jeremiah, the 20th chapter. O Lord, you have enticed me, and I was enticed. You have overpowered me, and you have prevailed. I have become a laughingstock all day long. Everyone mocks me. For whenever I speak, I must cry out. I must shout violence and destruction. For the word of the Lord has become for me a reproach and a derision all day long. If I say, I will not mention him, or speak any more in his name, then within me there is something like a burning fire shut up in my bones. I am weary with withholding it in, and I cannot. For I hear many whispering. Terror is all around. Denounce him. Let us denounce him. All my friends are watching for me to stumble. Perhaps he can be enticed, and we can prevail against him and take our revenge on him. But the Lord is with me like a dread warrior. Therefore my persecutors will stumble, and they will not prevail. They will be greatly shamed, for they will not succeed. Their eternal dishonor will never be forgotten. O Lord of hosts, you test the righteous. You see the heart and the mind. Let me see your retribution upon them. For to you I have committed my cause. Sing to the Lord, praise the Lord, for he has delivered the life of the needy from the hands of the evildoers. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Second reading is from Romans chapter 6. Should we continue in sin in order that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin go on living in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized in Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in death like this, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like this. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be destroyed, and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is freed from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. The word of the Lord. It is enough for the disciple to be like the teacher and the slave like the master. If they have called the master of the house of Beelzebul, how much more will they malign those of his household? So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered up that will not be uncovered, and nothing secret that will not become known. What I say to you in the dark, tell in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim from the housetops. Do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul.
Rather fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. And even the hairs of your head are all counted. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows. Everyone, therefore, who acknowledges me before others, I also will acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before others, I will also deny before my Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and one's foes will be members of one's own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Those who find their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. As we enter the summer months, when the days are longer and the summer's sun's warmth invites us to slow down and enjoy creation's abundant gifts, it's tempting to want to show up for worship and enjoy some easy grace. Light, simple, easy grace for easy summer living. However, this morning our lectionary does not offer such a gift. Pastors preaching this Sunday can choose from the book of Jeremiah, a lament from one of the most miserable and self-hating prophets compelled to speak God's word, or from Paul's masterpiece letter to the Romans to explore being united with our Lord and Savior in a death like his, or Matthew's gospel, where Jesus proclaims he has come to bring not peace, but the sword, pitting man against his father, daughter against her mother, daughter-in-law against mother-in-law. You get the picture. Thought-provoking, complex. Nary an easy answer in sight about God's judgment, justice, grace, and hope. And perhaps that's the gift of our scriptural tradition. My Old Testament professor once commented that individuals who enthusiastically claim the role and identity of prophet probably never read the book of Jeremiah. Jeremiah was appointed by God prophet to the nations to pluck up, pull down, to destroy and overthrow, to build and to plant. An enormously complex task during a tumultuous time in Israelites' history. Successive kings had failed to keep covenant with God in their leadership. Corruption pervaded the highest levels of society, including the priests and the other so-called prophets, contributing to rampant greed and injustice as the nation continued to fail to care for the most marginalized in their midst, the widow, the orphan, and the poor. It was a volatile period that Jeremiah rightly saw would result in war and the Babylonian exile. Israelites claimed righteousness, showing up for worship in the temple. And yet, as Bible Project scholars remind us, outside the temple, they were participating in idolatrous behavior, including, as evidence suggests, ritual child sacrifice. Tortured by the pain he saw unfolding around him, Jeremiah was compelled to proclaim God's judgment and justice. And he was uniformly rejected by God's people and forced to bear the disastrous consequences of their decisions as he accompanied them into exile. silence in Jeremiah's words we hear today may make us feel uncomfortable. He claims God enticed and overpowered him, akin to accusing God of grooming and rape. Jeremiah's humiliation is palpable. When he laments, he is a laughingstock, mocked by everyone for his prophecy. In his despair, he too rejects his divine call, but in the end acquiesces that he cannot. For it is like a burning fire in his bones. As uncomfortable as Jeremiah's pain and anger towards God and God's people may be for us to hear, his commission is perhaps as troubling. We like to hear God's call to build and to plant, but to pluck up, pull down, destroy, and overthrow? Not so much. Yet God's judgment demands repentance and courage to serve God. There can be no grace without judgment. There'd be no need. And God's judgment is just. An easy grace without accountability is just not sustainable. Therefore, I began wondering if Jeremiah is our model for prophetic discipleship in the 21st century. Like Jeremiah, we too are living in a volatile world. The speed of globalization, climate change, and technology over the last 60 years has led to tremendous uncertainty and a vastly complex environment that we are all navigating. In response, God's people are feeling deeply vulnerable and are responding by resisting change, acting out in ways revealing the worst of our humanity: random violence, culture clashes, and as Daryl Guter suggests, feelings of anger and resentment that someone has left us with this mess. The growing mental health crisis and opioid epidemic indicates others are turning dangerously inward. Recent news headlines attest to the greed and corruption at the highest levels of government and a pervasive injustice throughout our nation. In response to this constant and unpredictable change, I suggest that God's people are again participating in a form of ritual sacrifice, targeting women, minorities, and our LGBTQ+ neighbors as sacrificial scapegoats, denying their autonomy and inclusion in community through inequitable laws. And so I wonder, who are we as God's people here at God's Love in Newtown, PA? Do we identify with the widow, the orphan, or the poor? The ones for whom Jeremiah stood with in solidarity, proclaiming God's justice? If so, then we find comfort, for God is on our side. Do we identify with God's people who rejected Jeremiah and his prophecy with ridicule or even worse, threats? Have we participated in those forms of behavior? Social media is rife with this. Or are we here at God's Love willing to be Jeremiah for our place and time? Are we willing to be God's prophetic disciples of biblical hospitality that courageously pluck up, pull down, destroy, and overthrow all that is an affront to God? Political corruption, economic greed, systemic racism and bigotry, so that we may build up and plant God's inclusive kingdom here on earth. Like Jeremiah, are we willing to endure the personal and collective cost that it might incur regardless of the outcome? Are we willing to be God's faithful people, both inside and outside the church? God exhorted Jeremiah, "Do not be afraid." And Jesus reminds us the same in Matthew's gospel, while still proclaiming he did not come to bring peace but the sword. For Jesus understood, as Jeremiah who came before, there can be no real peace without justice. And God's judgment will render conflict between those who receive God's word and those who will not. Yes, Jeremiah was called to pluck up, pull down, destroy, and overthrow, but also to build up and plant seeds of hope in a God who through him proclaimed also a new covenant. A new covenant with God's people, inscribing the laws on their hearts, forgiving their iniquity and remembering their sin no more. Claiming, "See, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is anything too hard for me?" No, I don't think so. That same God incarnate, Jesus Christ, offered himself on the cross and was resurrected to new life. It is therefore our God can boldly declare to us this morning, those who find their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. In this, we find our hope. For a godly, self-sacrificial love is the sustainable grace we need for the complex and uncertain times in which we are living. When there are no easy answers, and only a sustainable grace will do. That which Jeremiah prophesied and Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, bore on the cross. A call to repentance, confession, forgiveness, and self-sacrificial witness to God's judgment and hope, justice and grace for all God's people. This is a sustainable grace that in whatever we may encounter by the faith of divine love in us, we will prevail. And this is the true gift that we find in our scriptural tradition, one that still speaks to us today. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you.
together using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Trusting in God's abundant mercy, let us offer our prayers for a world in need. You entice your church to speak truth that challenges false notions of peace. Prevail upon us with the good news of Christ's death and resurrection, that we are compelled to share the gospel with all the world. God, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Under your watch, not even a sparrow goes unnoticed. Safeguard plant and animal habitats threatened by melting glaciers, rising oceans, and receding coastlines. Amplify the voices of those calling for responsible stewardship of the Earth's resources. God, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Our world is enduring violence and destruction. Rescue your people in nations experiencing conflict or crisis, especially Ukraine and Russia, Israel and Palestine, Syria and Turkey and Uganda. Thwart the efforts of those who sow chaos and terror and guide those working to bring about peace and reconciliation. God, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
You have counted even the hairs of our heads. Reassure anyone experiencing poverty, homelessness, unemployment, or exploitation that every life has value. Look favorably upon all who struggle, especially Marilyn Foster, Steve Levenberg, Robert Daly and family, Todd Orr, Ruth Bartels Griffin, Eric Nordberg, Nancy McGuire, Nick and Geraldine Anselmi, Sylvia Vinkope, Christine Topin, Andrew Glassbrenner, Michelle Young, Ryan Acanelli, Keith Drozda, David Seifert, Adriana D'Elia, Carolyn Snyder, and those who name aloud or silently. Answer us, for your steadfast love is good, God, in your mercy. Even when we experience rejection, your love invites us to new life. Lift up anyone who feels shunned or excluded on account of their gender, race, sexual orientation, gender identity, national origin, or any other human distinction. Make your people one, God, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
All who have died with Christ also live with him. We give thanks for Philip Melanchthon and all the saints whose faithful confession and prophetic vision inspires our own discipleship and raises us with them to eternal life. God, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Receive our prayers and answer us, O God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share the peace. At this time, we give thanks and praise for the generosity of this congregation that extends beyond the walls of this church and out into the world in service to community. The offering plates are available at the rear of the sanctuary to receive your gifts at the conclusion of worship today. Let us pray. God of field and forest, sea and sky, you are the giver of all good things. Sustain us with these gifts of your creation and multiply your graciousness in us, that the world may be fed with your love, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen.
hand as you are able. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels and with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Again, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Let us join together praying and praying boldly using the words our Lord taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. All people are called to Christ's table. Come. Eat what is good. Please be seated. For the manner of distribution this morning, the ushers will invite you up to the front of the altar. When you come to receive at that time, please indicate if you desire a gluten-free wafer or grape juice. Come, taste and see that the Lord is good. Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Let us pray. We thank you, generous God, for the refreshment we have received at your banquet table. Send us now to spread your generosity into all the world through the one who is our dearest treasure, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Morning.
Morning.
A couple of announcements about our life together, especially this summer. Next week begins our summer worship schedule. So worship will be one service starting at 9:30. So our summer worship schedule starts next Sunday, 9:30. We will gather as one for July and August. We before returning to our to worship regular scheduled program, if you will, immediately following Labor Day weekend. So next Sunday, 9:30. We will also continue to offer our online worship experience. So as many of you engage in some much needed summer vacation and travel plans, visiting family, I encourage you to still stay connected with us online. Those are posted immediately following the service. There's no Book of the Month Club tomorrow. That's on hiatus for the summer, and we are looking at our adult education programming, reevaluating the offerings for the fall. So I just wanted to note there's no Book of the Month Club tomorrow evening. Any other announcements for the good of the church? Right. Please stand as you are able. The God who calls across the cosmos and speaks in the smallest seed, bless, keep, and sustain you, now and to the end of the age. Amen. Amen.
Share the harvest.